I want to talk to you today about your lives as the Christian family here, but I want to talk to you about your Sundays. Now, Sundays are just one day a week, but you have to admit that it is an important day of the week, the first day of the week, first day in the sequential order of our weeks and or days in our week. But it is first in importance, the day of the resurrection of Christ and the day that the New Testament shows us the church gathered. Not the only day they gathered. We'll look at that more in a second. But we are going to, in this first series of the new year, we are going to look in our sermon time at some basic matters that I think get put on the back burner because we're used to them, perhaps, or because, well, we just don't have the time, or we don't put the effort. And I think the latter is what's true. Don't put the effort into our Lord's Day that we need to, can do, and should do. And so, since it's on so many things, important things, simple things can be put on the back burner, it is also evidence that we very often, too often, let our crazy life overtake us and overwhelm us. Oh, you know what I'm talking about? The busyness of our lives, the struggles of our lives, the issues of our lives, the work, the family, the concerns, and the life just rolls on, and this is just a little part of it maybe, and it doesn't really have the importance that Jesus died to give, which this day certainly is. So I think if we're going to look at first things first, the very first thing we have to see is our time together on the Lord's Day. But it has a bigger meaning, though. It's what it means to be a part of the family. Be a part of the family. Now, when as was read to us, 3,000 people became Christians in one day, on the day of Pentecost. But it said that the Lord continually added to their number those who were being saved. So many people were becoming Christians. Knowing how they lived when the church was new is vital for our understanding of our day, of our relationship with God and His church. I mean, what does the New Testament show? I mean, that we can read with our own eyes about the need for the gathering of people, the gathering of God's people, Christian people, on this day, on the first day of the week, on the Lord's Day. What does the Bible show about all of this? So we're going to take a little walk through the New Testament right quick. I want you to go back to that passage that was just read, Acts chapter 2, verses 42 through 47. Acts 2, 42 through 47. This is the church in Jerusalem. This happened 50 days after the crucifixion of Christ, or 10 days or so after Jesus ascended back to the Father. This was the day the church began. This was God's plan and God's will. So let's read that again, if you don't mind. They devoted themselves. These are all those baptized believers. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers, all the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day, they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. It's a simple message they heard. They followed a simple commandment to repent and be immersed for the forgiveness of their sins. They were involved in simple worship. They had a simple church program. Be together and work together. Huh? How simple is that? Be together all the time and work together and share what you have. It's amazing to me. And the simple influence, the people around them were amazed at what was going on with these people. And God blessed them in number every single day. Now that's what we have the latter part, say AD 30, 33, whichever timeline people like to follow, 33 years, say, from the new time there. Acts 2:47, what do we see? How do we describe this family? They were excited, they were dedicated, and they were a functioning church family. They were getting it done, and they were glad to do it. And God was blessing their efforts. It was God's effort, by the way, the Holy Spirit's effort. They were the willing people that let God and the Spirit work through them. Now, what's important is that this is the benchmark for it all. This is the beginning. But we have in our New Testament, we have a very unique timeline that allows us to see every few years how the church functioned and how they were in their lives and in their faith. You know, say, let's give them 20 years. 20 years down the road from that great, great day of Pentecost. They're in the beginning of it all. What do we see? We find the church in Corinth. The church in Corinth. 1 Corinthians 11, please. 1 Corinthians 11, starting in verse 17. Now what do we see? This is about 20 years later. 20 years down the road, and what do we find in the church? Following the model, same attitude, same love, same fire, same effect. Listen to this. Paul writes to the church in Corinth, "In the following directives, I have no praise for you, for your meetings do more harm than good. In the first place, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you, and to some extent, I believe it. No doubt there have to be differences among you to show which of you have God's approval. When you come together, it's not the Lord's Supper you eat, for as you eat, each of you goes ahead without waiting for anyone else. One remains hungry, another gets drunk. Don't you have homes to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you for this? Certainly not." You know what we have here? We go from excited, dedicated, and functioning church in Jerusalem, 20 years later, we have mayhem. You know mayhem. He doesn't work for an insurance company, by the way. Mayhem, craziness, ineffective, division, ugliness. The love isn't there. The unity and cohesive nature of the Church of Jesus Christ is not even present. They get together and it does more harm than good. Now, read into that, should have just stayed home and things might have been better. Think about that. It only took 20 years. 20 years for this stuff to happen. Now, give it another 30 years. How about that? Another 30 years. We have the benchmark. We have plus 20 years. And then another 30 years goes by or so, and we have not a church, but we have a group of Christians, the Jewish Christians. Hebrews 10. The book of Hebrews, chapter 10. Hebrews 10, starting in verse 22. Now, the Hebrew writer is trying to encourage a church that is and Christians that are really struggling, really struggling. Verse 22 shows, okay, this is what needs to happen. "Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for He who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. What's the day? That's the day of the Lord. They were living in anticipation of the coming of Christ. Now, very important words there. 30 years later, what do we see? We see worship and fellowship was not a high priority for these Christians. Getting together on the Lord's Day, let alone day to day and house to house like the first church, it was not a priority. Whatever. I don't need it. It's not fun. It doesn't move me. Whatever. They just don't want to. Now, some were afraid to come together, because they were being beaten for it and persecuted and just showing up at a place where the Christians met. They felt harm to their lives, their bodies. But they were not coming together. They had stopped coming together, at least some, maybe most. Now, at the end of the first century, at the end of that first century, so over this 60, 70 year time span, at the end of all this, what we find is Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2. And we're going to read the first five verses. So at the end of the first century, how does the church compare to the first church that was excited and dedicated and functioning as a church family? And then 20 years after that, mayhem in worship. And then after that, after another 30 years, fellowship was not a priority. People were not coming together to worship. What do we see here? Revelation chapter 2, starting in verse 1. These are the words of the risen and glorified heavenly Christ. The angel of the church, or to the angel of the church in Ephesus, write, "These are the words of Him who holds the seven stars in His right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know you cannot tolerate wicked men, but you have tested those who claim to be apostles and are not, and have found them false." So that's good. They had some great things going on. They were not all, gone and lost as far as that's concerned. He praises them again. "You have persevered and have endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary." They have not given up. And the Lord hasn't given up on them, by the way. But He does say this, verse 4, "Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love." It is very possible, my friends, for a Christian and a group of Christians to do great things in the name of Christ. To be in the Word, to prove its validity, to believe its truths, to persevere when we're mocked or when people are on our case about it or things like that. We can do this. But I want you to notice the heart of the matter. They were falling out of love with Jesus. They still came together. They still did some good things. But they didn't love Jesus with all their heart and soul and strength and mind. They just didn't love Jesus like they used to. Didn't love Christ like they used to. And so this move from the excited, dedicated, and everyday functioning faith to a church life on life support only took 60 years. That's three or four generations from Acts chapter 2 to the book of Revelation chapter 2, the end of the first century. So with that sad truth in mind, is 1 hour a week enough? Is an hour a week enough? Is that where we come to? An hour a week. An hour a week of worship. An hour a week of getting together, a little bit of fellowship. An hour a week of learning. I mean, in my mind, I'm trying to think about wow, what you can really pack into that 1 hour to make it so awesome that we will be the people that God wants us to be. I mean, can a church and a Christian, I mean, for that matter, grow in faith and dedication and maturity as the family of God? Can we grow in all of that if the family of God is not a priority? If the assembly is not a priority? If our gatherings together don't really mean as much as they're supposed to mean? I mean, think about that Acts 2 church. We're going to keep coming back to that. That Acts 2 church was strong and it was growing by Holy Spirit power, but Holy Spirit power in willing, unified, and often together Christians. That's why they were like they were. That's why God added to their number every day. Because they were willing for the Spirit to work in their lives. They gave it the time it needed. Joyfully, excitedly, gave it the time that was needed. Now, folks, I understand. Full well, by the way. I understand that we need our alone time with God. I need it. I do it every single day. To the extent that I need to be better at it, you know, you can be the judge. I need to be way better at that special, beautiful, alone time with God, me and my Bible and my Lord and prayer. I need that. But I also need my small group experiences. I have multitudes of those, I mean many, every week of small groups of Christians getting together at night or early in the morning and studying and praying and talking and enjoying the company of just a small group of friends getting together for spiritual purposes. I must have that to be the type of man that can be a part of this type of church. I must have that. And then there's those close friends, the one I'm people that I'm closest to more than anybody. I need that time. I need that regular people time, by the way, you know, where I'm not on duty. You know what I mean by that? Where Barry can be Barry. You may not want to see Barry just being Barry. Anyway, but I crave that right there. But it still never takes away this one foundational truth. The church family must gather together to grow together. Write that one down. We must gather together to grow together. And folks, if that will be our intent, God will bless us when we put first things first on the first day of the week. First things first. You know, the way God designed the Christian life was to put us in a church family. This is God's design through His Son. Jesus built this church with His own blood, bought it with His own blood. I mean, it's the creation of God the Father and the power of the Spirit and the moving of the Word of God through this world. And God made us to be in this church family. You know, first, we have to remember some things. And I want to make sure that you know that I understand. I understand what this means. We all have different responsibilities. We're all in different seasons of our life. We are at different places in our family life and marriages and kids and everything. We're at different ages. We have age issues and circumstances. We have health and work and school and family and job and blah, blah, all that kind of stuff. But as Christians, we still have one great need. Regardless of whatever your circumstances are, we have one great need. We need each other. We need each other. And so will an hour a week satisfy that need? That's all I'm asking you to consider. Will an hour a week or two or three or whatever, will an hour a week satisfy that great need? Will it give us the strength to finish the race? Will it give us the equipment and the tools to fight the good fight of faith? And fight it hard and fight it all the way to the end, to that finish line. You know, these are the types of things that take time. It takes time with the family of God. The church is built with this foundational makeup of family getting together so that we can help one another. It is God's design for the disciples of Jesus Christ, which we claim to be. And so in this family, we worship together, we serve together, we mature together, and we fight the good fight together. And so for that to happen, we must what? Be together. That is why the first church were together day to day and house to house. I want us to be that church. I want us to be that kind of people that desperately want it and pray for it all the time. And I figure the more that adopt it and pray for it and desire it, we will get there. So I have a proposal. Actually, I have two proposals. Two proposals. First proposal is this, that each of us will make a commitment to make our church family a priority. Make this a priority, this church family here. We're the people of God, called by His name. We sing it, but do we need it? And do we believe it? Make it a priority. So I'm simply going to ask, let's do it this way, because I got some, definitely not all members of this church here today. Just look around. You can see that for yourself. But would you consider making the assembly, starting there, making the assembly a priority and encouraging others to make it a priority? Would you even consider joining the 150 members or so of your church family that will actually come tonight and end their Lord's Day together in worship, in praise, and in the Word of God? What have you got to lose? What have you got to lose? I've heard that over the last few months all the time. What do you have to lose? Nothing. Everything to gain. And so would you join us in our PM service? What about making a commitment to choose one of our excellent Bible classes on Sunday and Wednesday, taught by willing, good teachers in this church? They are of this body. They are your brothers and sisters. They are in your family. And I know they would love for everyone, to make that commitment and be with the family in learning together. How awesome would that be? What have you got to lose? Would you consider becoming a part of the family like the first Christians did, the day-to-day and the house-to-house? We have nothing to lose. We have everything good to gain if that will be who we are. That's my first proposal. My second proposal is this, and you gotta work with me on this one, okay? Work with me. My second proposal is each of us devote the Lord's Day to the Lord and His body. That each of us will devote this day to the Lord. The whole day. 3 o'clock is coming. And at 3 o'clock, I know where my mind's going to be now. Because I know it's about the Lord. And I don't ever want to forget that. That we need to devote the Lord's Day to the Lord and His body. Not just the body of Jesus, but the body of Jesus that sits in this room. Don't ever, just think about this. Now think about Sabbath for a second, this idea of Sabbath. Biblical teaching, obviously. When the Sabbath that was instituted after the creation, when the Sabbath was then made a part of the law of Moses, God commanded that His people, Israel, that the community of Israelites, they would work hard all week, and then they, on that one special day, would put their regular work aside for a day that is focused on God and the community of God. Not just God. The community of God. They're a family of God, Israel was. And the reason that this is important for us is that we can never let our relationship with God and worshiping God together and our relationship with Him and His people become lost to our busy lives. And oh, it happens. It happens all the time. It happens all the time. Under the old covenant, the old law, the Sabbath was from sundown till sundown the next day. You understand that? Sundown to sundown. 24 hours. Our Lord's day is a 24-hour period, folks. We look at the Lord's day as 9 o'clock to 10 o'clock and 10 o'clock to 11 o'clock. And 11 o'clock, bam, it's eat and then home. We got to get away from that, folks. We absolutely have to get away from that mentality. Under the old covenant, it was 24 hours. So would you consider preparing for the Lord's day earlier on Saturday night? I mean, starting to get in the spirit of the Lord's day, as John wrote it to at the end of Revelation. You know, I mean, he was on in the spirit of the Lord's day when he started it. At the end, he was begging for Jesus to come. In the spirit on the Lord's day, would you consider preparing for the Lord's day earlier on Saturday night? Because if you do that, you and I, we will be rested. We'll be able to get up the next day, a little bit less grouchy maybe, and make it to Bible class. If we prepared earlier for the Lord's day and took it seriously, we will be on time and we will be ready to learn and ready to worship. We'll be ready to be about the activities of this day that are focused on God and people. When we prepare ourselves, then end our day like we began, in worshiping our Lord together as a family at the end of the day, and have the day of the Lord mean something so special. So the personal and congregational benefits of making the Lord's day all about the Lord will bless every one of us. We will all be blessed. This church will be blessed. So will an hour a week get this done? Will an hour a week make this happen? I can't see how. I can't see how. I want you to turn to Revelation 13, and we'll finish here. Revelation chapter 13. John saw these incredible visions that were in multiple visions, really of the same thing, but in just different ways to make sure they got it. To see how the Christians were being hurt by society, by the government, by people that opposed God and people that opposed Jesus and opposed the Christians. People were dying. People were dying for Jesus. And so let's just read a few lines. Revelation 13 starting in verse 4. Revelation 13 starting in verse 4. Men worshipped the dragon because he had given authority to the beast. And they also worshipped the beast and asked, "Who is like the beast? Who can make war against him?" The beast was given a mouth to utter proud words and blasphemies and to exercise his authority for 42 months. Not long, but long enough, right? He opened his mouth to blaspheme God and to slander his name, his dwelling place, and those who live in heaven. He was given power to make war against the saints, that's the Christians, and to conquer them. And he was given authority over every tribe, people, language, and nation. All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, all whose names have not been written in the book of life, belonging to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world. He who has an ear, let him hear. If anyone is to go into captivity he will go. If anyone is to be killed with the sword he will be killed. And here's the line. This life, these realities, right? This calls for patient endurance and faithfulness on the part of the saints. Now listen up. Of all the families of God that we looked at in Jerusalem and in Corinth and the Jewish church at large and in the church in Ephesus, which of these families of Christians will be strong enough and ready to fight that fight? that we just read about. Which one, which church will stand? Which church will be able to be fired up enough, strong enough, equipped enough to say, let's get out there and talk about Jesus come what may? Which one will do it? Will Ephesus? No way. Because they didn't love Jesus very much anymore. Ephesus would not get it done. What about the Hebrew church? Not them either. Because they stopped going to church together. They stopped assembling together. What about the Corinthian church? No. Their worship was a crazy, dysfunctional mess. Which church? The Acts 2 church. Because they put the time into it. And they made the commitment. And they were together day to day and house to house and all the time. They were just amazed at the things that God was doing through them because they were the willing people God was doing that work through. The Acts 2 church can be that church that can stand up to the things that we just read that are now and in our future and will always be a threat to the church of Jesus Christ. We need to be that kind of church. And so my prayer is this. That all of us here make the full commitment. Make a full commitment together to the Father, to the Son, to the Spirit, to the church. Commit to worship. Commit to the Word. Commit to discipleship. And the time that it takes for us to grow together and honor God all together. And grow all together. And get strong. All together. That is what we need. Then we'll be strong and fruitful together. We can do this if we will all make that commitment. And our day is not going to cut it, folks. Let us get together with joy and expectation and being prepared for what we do on the Lord's day and every day, right? Now, before I pray and then we sing, part two of this lesson is tonight. We've been studying the book of 1 John, which gives us the most incredible message of how God loves us and will bless us and help us become the Christians that we can be. I mean, how great it is to be able to walk in the light as He is in the light and have the continual cleansing of the Son of God in our lives when we deal with sin and all the challenges of life. And John has this wonderful message that Jesus can mature us. If we're going to live this life that we talked about this morning, we need the Lord to make us mature people. How does Jesus mature us? I'll let you know tonight. Please come back. Please end your day with this family and let's make a commitment to be this kind of church. Let's stand. We're going to pray. And then you are welcome to come for any reason at all and let us know your needs. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray Your blessings on this church. I pray, Father, that we will be people of the assembly, that we will assemble in this building, in our homes, with our friends, with our neighbors, that we will get together all the time, day to day, house to house, that we will be serious in our life. Father, we know that we can't have a life with You that is limited to just a few minutes every now and then. Father, this is our life. This is everything. Father, help us to make the commitment and keep the commitment to be the people of God called in His name. Father, thank You for this time together. Father, I pray that this entire Lord's Day will be a praise to You and a benefit to us, and we'll know it's true when we lay our heads down tonight when it's all over. Father, thank You for this church and for the blessing of being a part of them. Father, I move anyone who needs prayers or help or the day of beginning their life with You. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all sing.